The next case on the docket in the matter and care of treatment of Thomas Easterberg, 117933.
Good morning, may it please the court. Michael Whalen on behalf of Thomas Easterberg, the appellant in this matter. And with the court's permission, I would ask for 5 minutes rebuttal time.
5 minutes is granted.
A brief history of the case. In 2006, Mr. Easterberg was charged with rape and aggravated criminal sodomy. He pled to kidnapping and aggravated battery. The state of Kansas, who is prosecuting him now in this case, dismissed the charges of rape and aggravated criminal sodomy. On his sentencing journal entry for the purposes of registration, the district sentencing court marked that his crimes were not sexually motivated.
And that's for purposes of CORA, the Kansas Offender Registration
Act. Yes, Your Honor. As I said, it was for registration.
And another clarification on that point, was that something that was found at the sentencing hearing, or is that just something that was checked off on the journal entry? Was it discussed? How did that finding find its way to the journal entry?
That information I don't have, Your Honor. I don't have the transcript of the sentencing hearing. We have a judicial finding.
It's made at some point. We don't know if it was in open court or if it was just something. You don't have it where that determination was made or when it was made.
It would have been at sentencing. It's the journal entry of sentencing by the sentencing judge. Yeah. But no, I don't know if this was something that was argued, or if there was a presentation. I don't have that answer, Your Honor.
Thank you.
And that was in the journal entry of sentencing.
Yes, Your Honor.
And did both attorneys sign off on that?
Yes, Your Honor. Okay. We come forward 2016, 10 years later, he served his time. The state files a petition to have Mr. Easterberg found to be a sexually violent predator. At the preliminary hearing, the only testimony presented by the state was that of Dr. Grimmel. On questioning and cross-examination, he was asked, did Mr. Easterberg commit a sexually violent crime? He said no. And what I did in cross-examination is I took him through the statute. And it's 5929A03A, which states who can be brought through the process to be determined to be a sexually violent predator, to be determined.
As much as I would like to agree with you, I'm not sure I can get there with the language. It's who qualifies who has to notify, and the people that are in charge of the custody of those different categories of people are charged with the responsibility of notifying that the person is about ready to be released and that it appears they may be subject to the SVPA, which is a little different than defining that's all the people that fit the definition of sexually violent. But,
well, I guess without that definition, a person is not brought into the system to have the evaluation to be reviewed by the multidisciplinary team. I understand the court's point, and I respectfully disagree, because what it says is these are the people, and sets a definition. And where this comes into play as well, Your Honor, is the state's argument in district court, and one that they've held here, is that any person charged with a sexually violent crime can be subject to being found to be a sexually violent predator, regardless of the outcome of the case or the underlying convictions. And that's what the district court said, is he was charged with this, so we can go forward. But the only evidence by the state was he never committed a sexually violent crime.
Well, the district court also said, didn't it, that he didn't see why they couldn't prove that at the hearing on the sexually violent predator petition.
Well, and that kind of leads into the next argument.
Well, but did the court say that?
The court said, well, this is going to be an interesting case because we're going to have to retry the criminal case.
It's going to be a retrial of the criminal case, and I didn't see anywhere where you made the argument that the dismissal of the sexually violent crimes, the statutorily defined sexually violent crimes, was with prejudice and could not be relitigated. In other words, the district court says we're going to have to retry. We're going to retry the kidnapping. But what was the effect of dismissing those that were sexually violent in the first instance?
I'm not sure I quite understand, Justice Johnson. I mean, the state agreed to dismiss those first cases, and what they're going to have to do...
No, I guess what I'm talking about is the effect of... You've already tried the case once.
No, right? Your Honor.
Well...
This is habeas. We have not tried anything yet.
The criminal case has been presented to the court and judgment entered, and it's already been tried.
Well, I plea agreement. Yeah, yes, Your
and
Honor.
I didn't see that you were arguing that you couldn't retry that first case, and that we had that the dismissal of those charges were without prejudice, the sexually violent ones.
With prejudice. He would have argued prejudice. They were with prejudice. The dismissal was with prejudice. You didn't make that argument.
I didn't make that argument specifically, no, but I would say that it was with prejudice. And if we are retrying them, and that's kind of what we come to here, is we're having a criminal trial, which makes the action unconstitutional. Couple of reasons. Number one, what the state is going to try and prove are the original charges of rape and aggravated sodomy to show that the kidnapping was sexually motivated. They are proving scienter, which under Hendricks takes it out of the realm of being a civil trial. Now, granted, motive, sexually motivated, and intent has been found to be two separate things in that it's not elemental. However, there are a couple of outcomes that if we retry this to make a finding of sexually motivated that impact criminally or line up with criminal presentation. First, under the new definitions of culpability and intent, knowingly incorporates what, how, why, and what the person was thinking when they were going forward. So I would say that the restructuring there, I think it's not just motivation, number one. Number two, they have to prove the elements of these crimes beyond a reasonable doubt in order to get to sexual motivation. Three, a finding of the crime being sexually motivated under KSA 22-3717-D1D could alter his sentence to lifetime post-release.
Where I see that perhaps making a difference is the state argued that the sexually motivated nature of kidnapping was not necessary to the criminal judgment, and so therefore it was not litigated, much like my colleague was asking. It was just a box checked. It wasn't litigated. But so I'm hearing you say that no, it would have, if it were sexually motivated, would have an impact on that criminal judgment because of the retroactivity. Were there other reasons that that had to be determined or that box had to be checked in the criminal case? We had CORA registration, but that's maybe part of the sentence, maybe not part of the sentence. But
this court says no.
But were there like other reasons that it had to be, that it was part of the criminal judgment? The state says it wasn't part of the criminal judgment, so it wasn't litigated.
Regardless, it's a judicial determination previously made. I mean, if you want to talk about the question of whether this act follows under Hendricks, you know, if we are merely trying to protect society from these types of people, what greater example of warehousing or penalty than to go after somebody who did not commit a sexually violent crime, was not convicted of a sexually violent crime, with a judicial determination that it was not a sexually motivated crime? And what I'm talking about as far as proving sexual motivation, if that's what happens in the SVP case, that determination under 223717 could then alter his post-release to lifetime. So we're having criminal impact, which takes it out of the realm of constitutionality under the Hendricks analysis. And what the trial becomes a criminal trial because the state has to prove a crime, ostensibly, other than what he was convicted of. And we're talking about having a criminal trial, which was the statement of the district court. We're going to have to try the criminal case.
Yes, Justice. Let me see if I understand that statement, what you're saying, that kidnapping that's sexually motivated would be a, if one is convicted of that, would be a different crime than straight kidnapping for which Mr. Easterberg was convicted. You're saying they're different crimes.
I'm saying what the state will have to prove are the original charges of rape and or criminal sodomy. That's what the underlying facts are that went with the original charge.
But I understood what they want to relitigate is they want to litigate the kidnapping charge being sexually motivated.
Which they can't do or prove beyond a reasonable doubt with proving the elements of another crime.
Well, why is that? I mean, it seems to me like you're arguing sexual motivation is entirely coextensive with the crime of rape, let's say.
Well, it's coextensive with the underlying facts in this case.
I understood you to argue that the state cannot prevail unless it proves up its rape allegation from the underlying criminal case. Is that what you're arguing?
More or less, that's what it's going to be. There are only three witnesses on the state's witness list. The two experts, psychologists, and the victim of the original crime. And so the state is having to prove something other than kidnapping.
Well, let's go at this a different way.
Okay.
If Mr. Easterberg had been convicted of kidnapping and the court had made the finding that it was sexually motivated, would he have been subject to a more severe sentence at that time than he was with the crime, the way it was on the judgment form? Was lifetime supervision came in later, right?
It did come in later, yes, Your Honor. But I see it as kind of an equivalent on the core argument that it was a procedural change that could be retroactive, which is why I'm saying if there was a finding of sexual motivation at this time, that it could still affect his criminal sentence.
Well, we're not talking retroactivity. I'm talking back then. And he would have been amenable to departure, but that was a whole different thing. That wouldn't have been amenable at the sentencing. They would have had to use the departure mechanism, and they didn't.
Yes, Your Honor. Oh, yes, I'm following you. Yeah. Yes. Yeah, if the court wanted to increase the post-release at that time, it would have had to have been by an upward departure.
I'm trying to get, he was tried for kidnapping. that was not sexually motivated? Can he be retried for kidnapping that is sexually motivated? That's where I'm trying to get at.
Okay.
And I'm wanting you to tell me why he can't be retried for kidnapping that's sexually motivated when he's already been convicted of kidnapping that was not sexually motivated.
Well, that's kind of my question. I don't know how he can be. He's being tried again for the same crime, and we get into the fact that what we're dealing with is beyond a reasonable doubt criminal standard to prove criminal elements, to prove sexual motivation, and it turns it into a criminal trial. Now, is there a question of him being retried as it falls under, and I'm not sure if this is where you're going, the idea of double jeopardy within this context. I don't know the answer to that.
You didn't make a double jeopardy argument.
Pardon?
You didn't make a double jeopardy argument. That's what I was trying to get to when we first started talking about
this. Okay, no, I did not make that argument. I like it. I mean, the court can adopt it if they find Justice Johnson or myself persuasive. The court is open and can do what they want. But I think the greater issue, personally, I'm sorry, Justice Rosen?
No, go ahead.
Okay. Sure. For me, the greater issue is coming back to Hendricks and the protections of the Sexually Violent Predator Act and its constitutional viability, which rests on the premise that it is not criminal in nature and it is civil. And if we are having a trial proving the elements of a crime beyond a reasonable doubt, that could also potentially have an effect on his criminal sentence. We are outside the realm of constitutionality under Hendricks and Zelling v. Young, because it's, as the district court said, we're retrying the criminal case.
Well, why are you retrying the criminal case? I'm still not convinced that that's what it takes. This is a procedure that is going to focus on a conviction of aggravated kidnapping, and then the question becomes whether that conviction arose from a sexually motivated purpose. And the to me is does the finding of the district court that it was not sexually motivated have any impact on that? Or can the state proceed on that one question as to whether the kidnapping was sexually motivated? That doesn't make you relitigate the kidnapping. That just focuses in on the motivation for the kidnapping, which to me is something separate. Justice Stegall pointed out, you don't relitigate the rape case. You don't have to prove rape or whatever other underlying crimes he was acquitted of. You have to show that it's sexually motivated. That might be include some of the allegations and some of the evidence there, but you're not relitigating and retrying him for rape or for the kidnapping. You're going to the motivation. And that's what's before the court.
That's part of the scienter. It's what they're having to reprove, is why and how he did this. His intent as a part of what he pled to and what was dismissed by the state. And they can't show this just as simple motivation. I mean, the court does not have before it the underlying facts of the original charge. And the allegations and what the state has to work with to try and show that it was sexually motivated is all evidence of other crimes of which he was originally charged. And I still believe that trying to prove sexual motivation takes that step into knowingly and scienter and in the new intent statutes related to culpability. And I do think it's significant that at the preliminary hearing, the district court found that he was not convicted of a sexually motivated crime. And the only testimony from the state was he was not convicted of a sexually motivated crime. It should have been dismissed there for not meeting the standard of the preliminary hearing. But the district court's finding was that the statute was directory, not mandatory. And the state makes the same argument. And I think that this is really significant, because the state says in their brief and in their response to the habeas that 5929A03A And those parameters definition that we must read in conjunction with the definition of a sexually violent predator, that subsection H, the exclusion clause that says nothing in this statute is jurisdictional and cannot be contravened. And so the state in their brief specifically says, obviously, the legislature meant to include people who don't fit any of these definitions. So that opens the door to the next question of, can anybody who's ever been charged with a sexually motivated crime, whether acquitted or not, whether charges are dropped, can they be brought into the sexually violent predator if they wind up in prison on a drug charge? Can the state then pursue them because they were once charged with a sexually violent crime? And as long as the state has the opportunity to prove it beyond a reasonable doubt at the sexually violent predator trial, anybody who has a prior charge can be placed into the system to be found to be a sexually violent predator. And, you know, maybe we don't have the underlying arguments, facts, or whatever, but we do have a judicial determination that this was not a sexually motivated crime. We have a finding in the district court and the evidence by the state that this was not a sexually motivated crime.
Thank you. Are there other questions?
We've got 5929A02E13 that specifically says that they can make that determination at the hearing on the petition to find Mr. Easterberg a sexually violent predator.
Correct. And
that's pretty plain language.
It is, except there are no procedures for using it. There are no jury instructions to go with it. And again, that's exactly the phrase that opens the door to anybody who has been charged with a sexually motivated crime can be prosecuted as an SVP. The state just has to prove it later on. Now, I've researched this nationally. There are only two cases where this phrase proved at trial has ever come up. And nothing is on point related to this case. I mean, this is first time up. And if they can prove sexual motivation at the time of trial, yet a person can only be brought into the SVP realm and prosecution because they've committed a sexually violent crime, how do we start at A when B isn't proven after 3 years in prison or in jail awaiting trial? I mean, the language is clear, but the application, and this was not an issue that was considered under Hendricks, Crane, or Selle. And this is a phrase that has never come up in Kansas, and as far as I can tell, once in Texas and maybe an Arizona case. It's a back door to get anybody that you want. And if you want proof of going outside the realm of the constitutionality of Hendricks, that this is not about retribution, deterrence, or punishment, saying that we can prove it at a later time, and we can take a person who's just finished their prison term and hold them in jail until such time that they prove that their crime was sexually motivated, not one for which they were convicted, but charged with, that we can prove it later on, is outside the bounds of constitutionality under Hendricks.
Are there other questions?
And I'm well over time, and I thank you, Your Honors.
All right, thank you.
You'll have another shot at me.
May it please the Court, I'm Assistant Solicitor General Dwight Carswell, appearing on behalf of the state. This court has no original jurisdiction over this proceeding, but even if the court did have jurisdiction, the petition should be denied. Mr. Berg was charged with a sexually violent offense, and he was also convicted of kidnapping, which was sexually motivated, and the state should be allowed to prove that at trial. As to this court's jurisdiction...
Mr. Carswell?
Sure.
Do we have enough information to know what that box being checked really means?
We don't know. There's nothing other than the fact that it is... is checked in.
So if we get past your jurisdictional arguments, don't we need to send this back to the district court to figure that out? I mean, doesn't that have impact, potential constitutional import, if there was already a finding supported by evidence that this crime that he was convicted of was not sexually motivated? Or does it just not matter because he's charged and you can prove it up in SVP? That should fall back.
I don't think it matters as a constitutional matter. For collateral estoppel, if it was actually litigated or not, could make a difference.
Yeah.
So that's something that he could raise in the district court proceedings. This is an original action, of course, so it's not a matter of remanding it to the district court. It's something he could raise in the district court.
We can
court
right remand now. Original actions.
You could. I mean, it would be the same as the ongoing district court proceedings. It could all be tied up there. The district court could look at what happened in the original case and make a determination as to whether collateral estoppel applies.
Okay, thank you.
Sure.
Since we got you stopped here, let's start at the beginning. I just looked at your original petition, and you alleged that he was charged with a sexually violent crime. You didn't allege that he was convicted of a crime that was sexually motivated in your petition.
I'd have to look at the petition again. My understanding is they'd usually just parrot the terms of the statute which was charged with or convicted of. And, I mean, convicted of a sexually violent offense would include, as part of that, that he was convicted of kidnapping that was sexually motivated, even if that wasn't specifically spelled out in the petition.
But you didn't say he was convicted of a sexually violent crime. You said he was charged. It reads to me as if you started this proceeding believing that the plain language that says convicted of or charged with a sexually violent crime, and that the charging gave the district court jurisdiction. And then you pivoted to say, well, the kidnapping conviction would fulfill that because we can prove it was sexually motivated later. But can you do that pivot when you didn't petition on that basis?
I'd have to look at the petition again to be sure what it says.
Well, assume you went with, hey, he's charged. Since he's charged, that's enough. Can we let you go, okay, well, I'm going to change my theory now to say the kidnapping was sexually motivated?
Our theory still is also that it's both that he was charged with.
Well, okay.
But yes, if for some reason that was not in the petition, I think the state could either amend its petition or file a new petition on that basis. And if it's not in the current petition, that's correct. I think we'd need to do one of those two
things.
And
let's talk about the sexually motivated motivation. The you point to, I think, 29A02E13 is the only place that sexually motivated is mentioned in the Sexually Violent Predator Act, isn't it?
I believe that's correct, yes.
And so it really doesn't give a definition.
It doesn't. I mean, I think that's something that, I mean, we know what motive is, we know what sexual intent is. So.
Okay, then, but it is defined in the criminal statutes.
I know it's defined at least in the lifetime post-release statute.
Right.
Although there.
And so I guess, is there a difference? Now, you would agree that the box that was checked was for the purpose of a civil, what we've determined to be a civil regulatory proceeding, a court registration.
That's correct.
Is there a difference between the definition of sexually motivated for CORA purposes or this civil regulatory SVPA proceeding? Do they have different definitions?
I think it would be the same definition. The statutory definition in the CORA context is basically the plain meaning definition.
So you have to rely on the fact, would you agree that if we consider it litigated in the criminal case, where it's signed by, checked by the judge, it's signed off by both parties, that creates a problem for you if it's already been determined under the same definition?
I don't think it creates a problem. We think collateral estoppel doesn't apply for three reasons. One is it wasn't actually litigated, but even if you put that aside.
Well, do you know it wasn't actually litigated?
There's no evidence that it was actually litigated. And as a petitioner seeking an original action in habeas corpus, that's his burden to prove. He can, again, still try to prove that in the district court. And then the two other reasons why we think collateral estoppel doesn't apply. First of all, the two proceedings are not of like extensiveness and quality. Your cases have distinguished and say collateral estoppel, for instance, doesn't apply between a criminal DUI prosecution and an administrative driver's license suspension hearing
but,
and vice versa.
I understand that, between a criminal and administrative or a criminal and a civil, but here we have a civil and a civil because that determination was made for purposes of CORA registration.
It was made
that
for
was
that.
The box. It was checked twice, wasn't it?
Yeah, I believe it was once for each conviction.
Right. Is criminal not sexually motivated for the criminal case? Check. It's not sexually motivated for CORA registration.
I believe actually what it was is there were two journal entries. If I could be wrong, but I think it was for the two different crimes, the kidnapping.
Let's not get hung up on that. But
sure.
It wasn't litigated, and it wasn't the same nature.
Mm-hmm. And then the third reason why we think collateral estoppel doesn't apply is because that's just a common law doctrine. It's not constitutional in nature. And the statute here specifically, this is E13 of the statute, says that this sexually motivated finding can be made either at the time of the trial or during the Sexually Violent Predator Act. So our position is the statute makes clear that even if the finding wasn't made at the time of the criminal case, the state is still...
But it doesn't say and. It says
or,
at the time of sentencing or at the time of this proceeding, but you want it to be and. If we find that it was actually a finding at sentencing, then you're saying we want it to be at sentencing and at this proceeding, and we want a different result.
No, I think the or supports our reading. I mean, the finding can be made at either time. It wasn't made in this case at the time of the criminal case.
If we don't agree with you and say that checking the box and signing off by counsel was tantamount to a finding, then what's your argument?
Well, it wasn't a finding of sexual motivation. It was a finding of the opposite.
Right.
So the finding of sexual motivation can be made in either context. Even if it's not made in the one, it could be made in the other, as we read the statute.
It's a finding of not.
It's a finding of not.
Yeah. And I think that's what he's trying to get at, mm-hmm. is that when you reference 13's permission to do this in the SVP proceeding, it doesn't say you can do it both places. It says you can do it here
there. Right? It says the finding can be made in either place.
Right.
So our
but
position
is
even
from
if it's...
and, obviously.
I'm sorry, what was that?
Or is different from and. And so if the finding has already been made and it's adverse to the state, 13 doesn't authorize it to be made again and possibly in favor of the state, does it?
I mean, if the statute said and, then we'd have to prove it at both places. The or makes it clear that you can prove it at either place.
I've got that.
Sure.
I think we'll just maybe disagree.
Okay.
Just
briefly
about,
addressing this court.
Would you mind, as long as we're here
in
preclusion doctrines, would you mind addressing res judicata
sure.
as well? Thanks.
Okay. Res judicata, or claim preclusion, deals with the claims. This is the Kansas Supreme Court explained in Hendricks. These cases involve different claims. A claim under the Sexually Violent Predator Act is not comparable to offense under the criminal statutes. And also a claim under the Sexually Violent Predator Act could not have been brought at the time of the criminal case. And so claim preclusion doesn't apply. Collateral estoppel or issue preclusion is the more relevant doctrine, but it doesn't apply for the reasons I've suggested.
And what about a claim under the CORA versus a claim under the Sexually Violent Predator Act?
There was a finding for purposes of CORA, but that was made in the context of a criminal case. That wasn't a separate claim, I would.
To be binding on CORA administration.
I mean, assuming that was a separate claim, just granting that point, it's still separate from Sexually Violent Predator Act. They're two different causes of action. They're different claims, even though they're both civil in nature. I briefly want to address this court's jurisdiction, because I think that's a threshold issue. At the time the Kansas Constitution was ratified in 1859, the term habeas corpus would not have been understood to include a proceeding like this one. Habeas corpus at the time wasn't available to challenge legal determinations as a general matter by courts that have jurisdiction. Instead, those determinations would need to be raised in the district court and then pursued on appeal. And this court, over the years, has repeatedly said that habeas corpus should not be a substitute for appeal, which is exactly what he's trying to do here. And even if this court had jurisdiction, it shouldn't exercise that jurisdiction for some of the reasons that the Tenth Circuit explained in Medina v. Choate. Now, that case dealt with whether habeas corpus is even available, but it also, the same reasoning would apply to whether this court should exercise its jurisdiction. And that, again, it's the same idea about these claims can be raised in the district court, pursued on appeal. Allowing habeas corpus would be disruptive to the trial process as it was here. This case has stayed in the district court, and Easterberg's just sitting in jail while this is going on. So it's disruptive, and there's no reason for this proceeding when he can appeal.
What can he appeal at this time?
Not at this time, other than if he were to try to pursue an interlocutory appeal, he could do that. But he did, in the 10th Circuit case, Medina v. Choate, that involved a speedy trial claim. The defendant said, I want this to be heard now. And the 10th Circuit said, well, you've raised it in the district court. You can wait till conviction, then appeal your conviction and assert your speedy trial claim on appeal. And the same is true here. He's raised these claims in the district court. He can continue to raise the claims in the district court. Ultimately, he may be found not.
So he has to wait 3 or 4 years to raise his claim on an appeal after the jury trial of the if he's found to be a sexually violent predator? Is that what he has to do?
It wouldn't take that long, usually, as a general matter.
No, we have lots of cases that take at least that long.
They're happening quicker, for sure. But also, I mean, some of the reasons they take so long is because people like in Ellison file original actions in this court, which delays proceedings in the district court.
Would you speak to the point that this is beyond what Hendricks ever intended? That was kind of the argument made here, that this is well beyond what the scope and what the design of the act in the first place was designed to accomplish.
Sure. Well, two main responses to that. First of all, the provisions we're relying on the same law. They were a law at the time of Hendricks was decided. So the U.S. Supreme Court presumably looked at them. It didn't specifically address, for instance, E13, but those were in the law at the time. So this is nothing new. And secondly, Hendricks made clear that the constitutional basis for commitment is dangerousness and a finding of mental abnormality. A conviction is not required as a matter of constitutional law. As the U.S. Supreme Court said in Hendricks, the conviction or prior charge conduct is just evidence of a person's mental abnormality or dangerousness. That's not a constitutional basis for commitment. I believe that covers the state's points, unless there are any further questions. Would urge you to dismiss or deny the petition. Thank you.
Thank you, counsel.
They are having to prove criminal elements again. They're going to have to, there's a distinction in the evidence and the level of what has to be done in this case versus the usual SVP trial. And part of that is, I mean, the court has said information about the prior crimes is admissible. But here, the state has to prove this information. They have to prove knowingly sexual motivated, and specifically as stated in Hendricks, scienter. That's what this becomes. It becomes a criminal trial, as was found by the district court. To go back to the res judicata question, and this court in State versus Martin basically said, in other words, res judicata is same claim, was this crime sexually motivated? Same parties, State of Kansas versus Thomas Easterberg, claims were or could have been raised. They apparently were raised, or at least the judge raised it himself in making the decision, and a final judgment on the merits. Maybe we're missing the merits issue or section there. But the crimes for which he pled to by themselves are not sexually motivated crimes. So even on the record and the knowledge this court has of what he pled to would lead the court to the ability to make its own reasoned decision that these were not sexually motivated crimes and made that finding. I concur with Justice Johnson. We're dealing with a single definition of sexually motivated. There's no distinction between and no new or different definition within the SVP Act. And I think that that's significant. The same language is already found once by the district court. And I was up here for a long time, my first round, and unless the court has other questions.
Can you address the state's jurisdictional argument? Jurisdictional argument. The question of our original jurisdiction.
Sure. Our position is Mr. Easterberg never should have been considered to be an SVP in the first place. He didn't fit the definitions.
Let me ask the question this way. Is it your position that the district court does not have jurisdiction over the state's petition?
Yes.
And so you're not, well, let me back up. If the state does have jurisdiction, I'm sorry, if the district court does have jurisdiction, do you concede the state's argument that we would not have original jurisdiction in habeas? I mean, that's what the state's arguing. The state's saying original habeas jurisdiction in this court is not available to test judicial decisions of a lower court that actually has jurisdiction.
The wrongful imprisonment of an individual based upon judicial error, lack of jurisdiction, or for unconstitutional reasons are all the basis to be able to bring it to this court.
So you think habeas, our original jurisdiction in habeas, is available to correct judicial errors of a lower court that has jurisdiction?
I would say in a plain situation, you know, go back to the Thomas case. Our argument there was the client's guardians were never served. Lack of service of process. And so the court didn't have jurisdiction. So yes, and we are claiming that there's a lack of jurisdiction due to the fact that the protocol wasn't followed and that my client does not fit these definitions and he's being held.
But even if the lower court does have jurisdiction and, let's say for purposes of argument, has made this error, your view is that we would have original jurisdiction in habeas to essentially to correct that error. And then the follow-up just is, doesn't that just short-circuit the whole appellate process?
Well, I'm coming from a basis of a lack of jurisdiction.
Okay.
And this court can
so you're hanging your hat on that determination. Rather than the judicial error hook. That's what I'm trying to
divine. This isn't just plain judicial error. This is a constitutional basis that my client is being deprived of his liberty improperly based upon
a lower court that
does not have jurisdiction because of the way this went forward. And yeah, all the evidence, my client did not commit a sexually violent crime. I mean, he doesn't meet, the preliminary hearing was deficient, but that's not our basis. I think that would be more of a judicial error question. We're going from the basis of, you know, wasn't convicted of sexually violent crime, wasn't found to be insane or mental defect. And that goes to the definition of charged with or convicted of. Because this is what the Hendricks Court dealt with when they said it's not required to have a conviction. Because charged with or convicted of must be read with AO3A, convicted of a sexually motivated crime, or not guilty by reason of insanity of a sexually motivated crime or mental defect. AO3 defines the definition in O2 of charged with or convicted of a sexually motivated crime. And if he was not convicted of a sexually motivated crime, for which there is a judicial finding, he doesn't get to be in the SVP process. That's the lack of jurisdiction. He doesn't meet any of the qualifications. Justice Johnson, did you have a question?
Well, that's subsection 8H plainly says this statute's not jurisdictional. I mean, I understand what you're...
Which is
on
exactly...
On a fairness basis, but that you shouldn't start a process where you don't fit the definition of the people that the process should be started for. But then H says, but this... isn't jurisdictional.
Which is what makes it constitutionally invalid, in my opinion, by the admission of the state. What they said in their brief specifically was subsection H, not jurisdictional, means that there are people that can be prosecuted who don't fit the definition of an SVP. That goes beyond, if that has no meaning.
And that should be taken care of then at the probable cause. And I understand your argument is, well, that didn't work in this case, But back to my colleague's question, if it didn't work in this case because the judge made an error of law, then why isn't that appealable rather than a jurisdictional defect? I think that's what he was asking.
Because
it's not a matter of process here. It wouldn't have been a matter, if the district judge would have says, hey, you don't fit the four categories of, should be noticed up to start the proceeding, so I'm going to kick it out, you know, then you'd have got what you wanted. I don't have jurisdiction. But the court found differently, so.
And the antithesis of that statement, Your Honor, is the court found it did have jurisdiction, and legally, and my presentation to this court is, it does not.
Then doesn't that mean that every time a sexually violent predator, or someone charged under this, loses at the probable cause hearing, they get a direct path through a habeas proceeding to challenge that? I mean, why not? Because you lost that. You say you lost it because you had good reasons to win it. And if you'd won it, he wouldn't be in jail. And so why don't you just get a direct appeal through habeas every time somebody loses the probable cause hearing?
Because this is beyond just losing the probable cause hearing. This is...
I mean, you lost really, really bad. I mean, I'm not... A loss is a loss. And I'm just trying to figure out why this qualifies for habeas when something else apparently doesn't out of a probable cause hearing.
Because the record here specifically developed attacking jurisdiction related to the terms and definitions of the Sexually Violent Predator Act that my client did not meet, that he never should have been considered for the program in the first place, depriving the court of jurisdiction, that there is a prior judicial finding that his prior crime was not sexually motivated, which takes him out of the statutes. They don't apply to him as a matter of law, and he is being held and deprived of his liberty interest because of constitutional deficiencies and a lack of jurisdiction, not just because I'm unhappy with the judge's ruling. I mean,
it really just still sounds like, because I had really, really good arguments and that are constitutionally based, and I lost. And so now we ought to get relief without having to wait for the rest of the proceeding.
In a criminal case, a preliminary hearing goes on. The state doesn't really put on any evidence. They just proffer evidence. And the judge says, that's enough. Is that an appealable issue? Or does that become a question of jurisdiction that the state took no action, presented no evidence? Is there a right to a habeas there? I would say that there is, because the state didn't present any evidence. They didn't meet their burden as a matter of law.
What's the case law support for that?
I couldn't tell you off the top of my head, Your Honor. But I think the definition of habeas and, you know, the reference in my brief about it, I would refer the court to my brief. There's a great definition of habeas that my PDF is messing up and I can't read to the court now. But I would stand on my arguments within the brief as it relates to that.
Are there other questions? Thank you, counsel.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Thank you to both counsel, and the court will take this matter under advisement. We will.